This is Jack Foley. The American novelist Thomas Wolfe was born on October 3rd, 1900, and died on September 15th, 1938. William Faulkner said that Wolfe might have been the greatest talent of his generation because he aimed higher than any other writer. Wolfe himself said, "I will go everywhere and see everything. I will meet all the people I can. I will think all the thoughts, feel all the emotions I am able, and I will write, write, write." I wrote furious, ravenous language, gone on the wind like bullets, cacophonies of voices, a whisper-tongued laughter. This deep song embedded in a narrative, how is that possible? Growth. 15 years old, I read amazed, shot down the brink of darkness, awakened to a larger world, a stone, a leaf, a door, not known but sought, the lost, known, unknown, ravenous, enveloping word that opened the gates of heaven. Today's show is a tribute to this great American writer. I'm going to begin with the opening of his book, Look Homeward, Angel, published 11 days before the stock market crash of 1929. A stone, a leaf, an unfound door. Of a stone, a leaf, a door, and of all the forgotten faces. Naked and alone, we came into exile. In her dark womb, we did not know our mother's face. From the prison of her flesh, have we come into the unspeakable and incommunicable prison of this earth. Which of us has known his brother? Which of us has looked into his father's heart? Which of us has not remained forever prison pent? Which of us is not forever a stranger and alone? A waste of loss in the hot mazes, lost among bright stars on this most weary, unbright cinder, lost, remembering speechlessly, we seek the great forgotten language. The lost lane end into heaven, a stone, a leaf, an unfound door. Where? When? O lost, and by the wind grieved, ghost, come back again. I'm going to follow that with a short story, originally published in The New Yorker on June 15th, 1935. The title of the story is Only the Dead Know Brooklyn. The speaker of the story is a man from Brooklyn who encounters Thomas Wolfe himself on the New York subway. Wolfe wrote the story in Brooklynese. There's no guy living that knows Brooklyn true and true, because it'd take a guy a lifetime just to find his way around the goddamn town. So like I say, I'm waiting for my train to come when I see this big guy standing there. This is the first I ever see of him. Well, he's looking wild, you know. I can see that he's had plenty, but still he's holding it. He talks good and is walking straight enough. So then this big guy steps up to a little guy that's standing there and he says, "How you get to 18th Avenue and 67th Street?" he says. "Jesus, you got me, chief," the little guy says to him. "I ain't been here long myself. Where's the place?" he says. "Out in the Flatbush section somewhere?" "Nah," the big guy says, "it's out in Bensonhurst. But I was never there before. How do you get there?" "Jesus," the little guy says, scratching his head, you know. You could see the little guy don't know his way about. "You got me, chief. I never heard of it." one of you guys know where it is? He says to me. Sure, I says. It's out in Bensonhoist. You take the 4th Avenue Express, get off at 59th Street, change to a Sea Beach local there, get off at 18th Avenue and 63rd, and then walk down 4 blocks. That's all you got to do, I says. Go on, says wise guys that I never saw before, pipes up. What you talking about, he says. Oh, he was wise, you know. The guy is crazy. I tell you what you do, he says to the big guy. You change to the West End line to 26, he tells him. Get off at New Utrecht at 16th Avenue, he says. Walk 2 blocks over, 4 blocks up, he says, and you'll be right there. Oh, a wise guy, you know. Oh, yeah, I says. Who told you so much? He got me sore because he was so wise about it. How long you been living here, I says. All my life, he says. I was born in Williamsburg, he says. And I can tell you things about this town you never heard of, he says. Yeah, I says. Yeah, he says. Well, then you can tell me things about this town that nobody else has ever heard of either. Maybe you make it all up yourself at night before you go to sleep, like cutting out paper dolls or something. Oh, yeah, he says. You're pretty wise, ain't you? Oh, I don't know, I says. The boys ain't using my head for a Lincoln statue yet, I says. But I'm wise enough to know a phony when I see one. Yeah, he says. A wise guy, huh? Well, you're so wise that someone's going to bust your one right under snoot someday, he says. That's how wise you are. Well, my train was coming, or I'd have smacked him then and there. But when I seen the train was coming, all I said was, all right, mug. I'm sorry I can't stay to take care of you, but I'll be seeing you sometime. I hope out in the cemetery. So then I says to the big guy who'd been standing there all the time, you come with me, I says. So when we gets onto the train, I says to him, where you going out in Bensonhoist, I says. What number are you looking for, I says. You know, I thought if he told me the address, I might be able to help him. Oh, he says, I'm not looking for no one. I don't know no one out there. Then what you going out there for, I says. Oh, the guy says, I'm just going out to see the place, he says. I like the sound of the name, Bensonhoist, you know? So I thought I'd go out and have a look at it. What you trying to hand me, I says. What you trying to do, kid me? You know, I thought the guy was being wise with me. No, he says, I'm telling you the truth. I like to go out and take a look at places with nice names like that. I like to go out and look at all kinds of places, he says. How do you know there was such a place, I says, if you've never been there before? Oh, he says, I got a map. A map, I says. Sure, he says, I got a map that tells me all about these places. I take it with me any time I go out of here. He says, and Jesus, with that, he pulls it out of his pocket. And so help me. But he's got it. He's telling the truth. A big map of the whole goddamn place with all the different parts. Marked out, you know, Canarsie and East New York and Flatbush, Bensonhoist, South Brooklyn, the Heights, Bay Ridge, Greenpoint, the whole goddamn layout. He's got it right there on the map. You been to any of those places? I says, sure, he says. I've been to most of them. I was down in Red Hook just last night, he says. Jesus, Red Hook, I says. What you do down there? Oh, he says, not much. I just walking around. I went to a couple of places and had a drink, he says, but most of the time I just walked around. Just walked around, I says. Sure, he says. Just look at its things, you know. Where'd you go, I asked him. Oh, he says, I don't know the name of the place, but I could find it on my map, he says. One time I was walking across some big fields where there ain't no houses, he says, but I could see ships over there all lighted up. They was loading. So I walks across the fields, he says, to where the ships are. Sure, I says, I know where you was. You was down to the Erie Basin. Yeah, he says, I guess that was it. They had some of those big elevators and cranes, and they was loading ships. And I could see some ships in dry dock, all lighted up. So I walks across the fields to where they are, he says. Then what did you do, I says.
Oh, I said nothing much. I came on back across the fields after a while and went into a couple of places and had a drink. Didn't nothing happen while you was in there, I says. No, he says, nothing much. A couple of guys was drunk in one of the places and started a fight, but they bounced them out. And then one of the guys started to come back again, but the bartender gets his baseball bat out from under the counter, so the guy goes on. Jesus, I said. Red Hook. Sure, he said. That's where it was, all right. Well, you keep out of there, I says. You stay away from there. Why, I says. What's wrong with it? Ooh, I says. It's a good place to stay away from, that's all. It's a good place to keep out of. Why, he says. Why is it? Jesus, what you gonna do with a guy as dumb as that? I saw it wasn't no use to try to tell him nothing. He wouldn't know what I was talking about, so I just says to him, oh, nothing, you might get lost out there, that's all. Lost, he says. No, I wouldn't get lost. I got a map, he says. A map? Red Hook? Jesus. So then the guy begins to ask me all kinds of nutty questions. How big was Brooklyn? And I couldn't find my way around in it. And how long would it take a guy to know the place? Listen, I says. You get that idea out of your head right now. You ain't never going to get to know Brooklyn, I says. Not in 100 years. I've been living here all my life, I says. And I don't even know all there is to know about it. So how do you expect to know the town, I says, when you don't even live here? Yes, he says. But I got a map to help me find my way about. Map or no map, I says. You ain't going to get to know Brooklyn with no map, I says. Can you swim, he says, just like that. Jesus. By that time, you know, I began to see that the guy was some kind of nut. He'd had plenty to drink, of course, but he had that crazy look in his eye I didn't like. Can you swim, he says. Sure, I says. Can't you? No, he says. No more than a stroke or two. I never learned good. Well, it's easy, I says. All you need is a little confidence. The way I learned, my older brother pitched me off the dock one day when I was 8 years old, clothes and all. You'll swim, he says. You'll swim all right. Or drown. And believe me, I swam. When you know you got to, you'll do it. The only thing is you need confidence. And once you've learned, I says, you got nothing else to worry about. You'll never forget it. It's something that stays with you as long as you live. Can you swim good, he says. Like a fish, I tells him. I'm a regular fish in the water, I says. I learned to swim right off the docks with all the other kids, I says. What would you do if you saw a man drowning, the guy says. Do? Why, I'd jump in and pull him out, I says. That's what I do. Did you ever see a man drown, he says. Sure, I says. I see two guys, both times at Coney Island. They got out too far, and neither one could swim. They drowned before anyone could get to them. What becomes of people after they have drowned out here, he says. Drowned out where, I says. Out here in Brooklyn. I don't know what you mean, I says. Never heard of no one drowning here in Brooklyn, unless you mean a swimming pool. You can't drown in Brooklyn, I says. You gotta drown somewhere else, in the ocean, where there's water. Drowning, the guy says, looking at his map. Drowning. Jesus, I could see by then he was some kind of nut. He had that crazy expression in his eyes when he looked at you, and I didn't know what he might do. So we was coming into a station, and it wasn't my stop. But I got off anyway and waited for the next train. Well, so long, Chief, I says. Take it easy now. Drowning, the guy says, looking at his map. Drowning. Jesus, I thought about that guy 1,000 times. And I wondered whatever happened to him going out to look at Bensonhoist because he liked the name. walking around through Red Hook by himself at night and looking at his map. How many people did I see get drowned out here in Brooklyn? How long would it take a guy with a good map to know all there was to know about Brooklyn? Jesus, what a nut he was. I wonder whatever happened to him. Anyway, I wonder if somebody knocked him on the head or if he's still wandering around in the subway in the middle of the night with his little map. The poor guy. Say, I gotta laugh at that when I think about him. Maybe he's found out by now that he'll never live long enough to know the whole of Brooklyn. It'd take a guy a lifetime to know Brooklyn true and true. And even then, you wouldn't know it all. That was Only the Dead Know Brooklyn, a short story by Thomas Wolfe. This next passage is another excerpt from Look Homeward, Angel. The hero of Look Homeward, Angel, who grows up during the course of the book, meets his dead brother, Ben. The hero is named Eugene, and he meets his dead brother, Ben, in the town square. The square lay under blazing moonlight. The fountain pulsed with a steady, breezeless jet. The water fell upon the pool with a punctual slap. No one came into the square. The chimes of the bank's clock struck the quarter after three as Eugene entered from the northern edge by Academy Street. He came slowly over past the fire department and the city hall. On Garrett's Corner, the square dipped sharply down towards Old Town, as if it had been bent at the edge. Eugene saw his father's name faded on the old brick in moonlight. On the stone porch of his father's shop, the angels he had made held their marble posture. They seemed to have frozen in the moonlight. Leaning against the iron railing of the porch above the sidewalk, a man stood smoking. Troubled and a little afraid, Eugene came over. Slowly he mounted the long wooden steps, looking carefully at the man's face. It was half obscured in shadow. "Is there anybody there?" said Eugene. No one answered. But as Eugene reached the top, he saw that the man was his brother Ben. Ben stared at him a moment without speaking. Although Eugene could not see his face very well under the obscuring shadow of his gray felt hat, he knew that he was scowling. "Ben?" said Eugene doubtfully, faltering a little on the top step. "Is it you, Ben?" "Yes," said Ben. In a moment, he added in a surly voice, "What did you think it was, you little idiot?" I wasn't sure," said Eugene somewhat timidly. "I couldn't see your face." They were silent a moment. Then Eugene, clearing his throat in his embarrassment, said, "I thought you were dead, Ben." "Ah," said Ben contemptuously, jerking his head sharply upward. "Listen to this, won't you?" He drew deeply on his cigarette. The spiral fumes coiled out and melted in the moon-bright silence. "No," he said in a moment quietly. "No, I am not dead."
Eugene came up on the porch and sat down on a limestone base, upended. Ben turned in a moment and climbed on the rail, bending forward comfortably upon his knees. Eugene fumbled in his pockets for a cigarette with fingers that were stiff and trembling. He was not frightened. He was speechless with wonder and strong eagerness, and afraid to betray his thoughts to ridicule. He lighted a cigarette. Presently, he said painfully, hesitantly, in apology, "Ben, are you a ghost?" Ben did not mock. "No," he said, "I am not a ghost." There was silence again while Eugene sought timorously for words. "I hope," he began presently with a small cracked laugh, "I hope then this doesn't mean that I'm crazy." "Why not?" said Ben with a swift, flickering grin. "Of course you're crazy." "Then," said Eugene slowly, "I'm imagining all this?" "In heaven's name," Ben cried irritably, "how should I know? Imagining all what?" "Well, what I mean," said Eugene, "is, are we here talking together or not?" "Don't ask me," said Ben. "How should I know?" With a strong rustle of marble and a cold sigh of weariness, the angel nearest Eugene moved her stone foot and lifted her arm to a higher balance. The slender lily stipe shook stiffly in her elegant, cold fingers. Did you see that?" Eugene cried excitedly. "Did I see what?" said Ben, annoyed. That angel there," Eugene chattered, pointing with the trembling figure. "Did you see it move? It lifted its arm." "What of it?" Ben asked irritably. "It has a right to, hasn't it? You know," he added with biting sarcasm, "there's no law against an angel lifting its arm if it wants to." "No, I suppose not," Eugene admitted slowly after a moment. "Only I've always heard..." "Ah, do you believe all you hear, fool?" Ben cried fiercely. "Because," he added more calmly in a moment, drawing on his cigarette, "you're in a bad way if you do." There was again silence while they smoked. Then Ben said, "When are you leaving, Jean?" "Tomorrow," Eugene answered. "Do you know why you were going? Or you were just taking a ride on the train?" "I know. Of course, I know why I'm going," Eugene said angrily, confused. He stopped abruptly, bewildered, chastened. Ben continued to scowl at him. Then, quietly, with humility, Eugene said, "No, Ben, I don't know why I'm going. Perhaps you're right. Perhaps I just want to ride on the train." "When are you coming back, Gene?" said Ben. "Why, at the end of the year, I think," Eugene answered. "No," said Ben, "you're not." "What do you mean, Ben?" Eugene said, troubled. "You're not coming back, Gene," said Ben softly. "Do you know that?" There was a pause. "Yes," said Eugene. "I know it." "Why aren't you coming back?" said Ben. Eugene caught fiercely at the neckband of his shirt with a clawed hand. "I want to go. Do you hear?" he cried. "Yes," said Ben. "So did I. Why do you want to go?" "There's nothing here for me," Eugene muttered. "How long have you felt like this?" said Ben. "Always," said Eugene, "as long as I can remember. But I didn't know about it until you..." He stopped. "Until I what?" said Ben. There was a pause. "You are dead, Ben," Eugene muttered. "You must be dead. I saw you die, Ben." His voice rose sharply. "I tell you, I saw you die. Don't you remember the front room upstairs that the dentist's wife has now? Don't you remember, Ben? Coker, Helen, Bessie Gant, who nursed you? Mrs. Pert, the oxygen tank? I tried to hold your hands together when they gave it to you." His voice rose to a scream. "Don't you remember? I tell you, you are dead, Ben."
"Fool," said Ben fiercely.
"I am not dead." There was a silence. Then said Eugene very slowly, "Which of us is the ghost, I wonder?" Ben did not answer. "Is this the square, Ben? Is it you I'm talking to? Am I really here or not? And is this moonlight in the square? Has all this happened?" "How should I know?" said Ben again. "Within their father's shop, there was the ponderous tread of marble feet." Eugene leaped up and peered through the broad sheet of Janitor's dirty window. Upon his desk, the strewn vitals of a watch winked with a thousand tiny points of bluish light, and beyond the jeweler's fenced space where moonlight streamed into the wareroom through the tall side window, the angels were walking to and fro like huge wound dolls of stone. The long cold pleats of their raiment rang with brittle clangor. Their full decent breasts wagged in stony rhythms, and through the moonlight, with clashing wings, the marble cherubim flew round and round. With cold yew bleatings, the carved lambs grazed stiffly across the moon-drenched aisle. "Do you see it?" cried Eugene. "Do you see it, Ben?" "Yes," said Ben. "What about it?" "They have a right to, haven't they?" And for a concluding passage, "Something has spoken to me in the night, burning the tapers of the waning year. Something has spoken in the night and told me I shall die, I know not where, saying, to lose the earth you know for greater knowing. To lose the life you have for greater life. To leave the friends you loved for greater loving. To find a land more kind than home, more large than earth, whereon the pillars of the earth are founded, toward which the conscience of the world is tending. A wind is rising and the rivers flow." My tribute to the great American writer, Thomas Wolfe.
Avacha.
They came running from the Klan, holding on to everything they had, while others were just looking for something to hold on to. The blues came west looking for freedom land. L.A., Sacramento, and San Francisco had that big city thing. Folks rocked in Russell City. Vallejo had a scene. Richmond had a kind of smooth Chi-Town sound of thing. But if you wanted a gut-wrenching, soul-taking, down-home blues, you know, the kind of blues that your mama warned you about, and the church warned you about, the kind of blues that made your hair stand on end, snatched you out of chairs, made you shout after a fool, jump up and dance, that good old makes you want to holler kind of blues, you have to come to Oakland. Oakland, the blues mecca of the West Coast. Steve was as wild and sophisticated as you were.
Storytelling for Social Change on KPFM.
welcome to Cover to Cover and Jovelyn's Bistro on this Tuesday. Hello, everyone, and hope everyone's having a joyful Tuesday wherever you are, whatever you're doing. Let's take a deep breath and just say, yeah. If we're breathing, it's a moment to be joyful. And today, to add to your joy, we're going to be talking with Lisa Dig, which I did not get that right with all the intentions I have. But just so some of you folks know her, some of you don't, some will get to know her today on this Tuesday and figure out what she's doing now. But she is the creator of Cow Pound Kosher Comedy. And she is bringing a show on Thursday that she's going to talk about the show, who's on the show, how did she start Cow Pound Kosher Comedy, which has a wonderful history. And I interviewed her months ago when she was in lockdown with her mama, and they started a whole comedy series. So I definitely have to catch up and find out what's going on. So welcome to Cover to Cover Jovelyn's Bistro. Lisa, how are you? And how do I say your last name?
Oh, you say it all kinds of ways, but I say it Geduldig. Very simple. Geduldig. Yeah, nobody gets it. Yeah, everyone panics and throws in some extra consonants, a couple of other vowels. But, Geduldig. So good to hear your voice again.
Yes. Lisa, catch us up. But first, tell us what's going down on Thursday. Once I received the notice, I said to myself, this is the time for some comedy for all of us, I'm sure. All the time good, but this time good. What's going on?
Well, since July of last year, I have been producing a comedy show called Lockdown Comedy on Zoom every third Thursday of the month. And even though things are opening up again, I still am running the show monthly, and we still have about 100 people attending, quote unquote. This Thursday, the fabulous Karen Williams, who is a black lesbian comedian who used to live in San Francisco and is in Ohio, she'll be on the show. And Daya Lakshmi Narayanan, you think Geduldig is hard to pronounce. She's of Indian descent, grew up in the South, lives in San Francisco, performs all over the world and does storytelling as well. And Avi Lieberman is an LA-based comedian. He's Jewish. He's performed at Kung Pao. And then my 90-year-old mother, Arlene Geduldig, who started doing comedy on my show last year when she was only 89, and me. And so I've been commuting back and forth between Florida and San Francisco. I went to visit my mom for 2 weeks, March of last year, and that turned into 17 months and spending quality time together and getting to know each other and running this comedy show out of her guest room.
And that was
in her retirement community.
In her retirement community. And first of all, you have a beautiful lineup, and so which is really great, which you always do. And I asked you this last time, and I'm going to ask you again for the listening audience. What do you look for in a comedian beyond funny? Because what I've noticed, what I've picked up, which is why I'm asking, is there's a level of intelligence and consciousness in the comedians that you bring to the stage. Is that a part of it? Is it accidental? Is it that they all wear purple? Or what's going on?
It's intentional. I like intelligent comedy. I like non-offensive, you know, comedy that's unique, thinking outside the box, multicultural lineup, and just different voices and people from all over the country. And I've had some folks internationally since I'm doing the Zoom show. So, you know, a lot of comedy shows, no offense to white straight men, but a lot of the shows are just white straight men. And there are a lot of people doing comedy that come from all different backgrounds and points of view. And what they bring to the stage is unique. So I like to have unique voices and unique backgrounds and people who are intelligent. And, you know, there's a lot of cheap comedy and there's intelligent comedy. And I like to bring to my stage, whether or not it's live or in cyberspace, intelligent, unique comedians with varied voices.
And I really appreciate that. As a storyteller, and I've done stand-up comedy, and I'm not actively doing it now. Mm-hmm. I'm working on a couple of the projects. And so what I like about your conscious decision, because you produce, is that it opens up our comedy palette, our laughing palette, when we have diverse people approaching comedy, humor, storytelling from the world in which they are born and raised and think about, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so when we think about, like, I was raised with in a household with five brothers, and their sense of comedy was, even though African-American, but the comedy on TV we saw was people hitting each other over the head of mm-hmm. I think, banana stick. And so their comedy was that. With just mm-hmm. like the punchline of somebody getting hurt. So I like that as I grew into stages, you're right, and I like that this is the kind of work you produce. How has this changed for your mother, you not just being there to connect and hang out in this part of who you are, the storytelling of who you are as mother and daughter now, how has this stressed her as moving into comedy?
How it was?
Professionally. How has it stretched her moving into comedy professionally?
Well, herself? It's been completely unexpected. Every single aspect of my being here, from me being here for a year and a half. I actually was just in San Francisco for a month. I'm back in Florida now. Tomorrow I'm going back to San Francisco, so I'm commuting these days. I'm now bi-coastal. I'm coming out as bi-coastal.
Mm-hmm.
The experience has been fabulous. My mom loves the stage, even though she hasn't ever performed on stage. She's performing in front of a screen. But as soon as she's in front of the screen, in front of the audience, I just see a transformation. And mm-hmm. she just finds her comic voice, and she just loves it. She's 90 years old. She talks a lot about, you know, having the hots for young firemen and, you know, any 30-year-old guys in uniforms. It's just such a great perspective. You know, you see someone who's her age, and you don't expect what she's going to say to come out of her mouth. And she's very playful. And what we've done the last 2 months, and we'll do that again this Thursday, is instead of me just introducing her and her performing, I've been her straight man, so to speak. We've been on the screen together, and I've been asking her questions, and then she's just been really funny. So I've just been sort of interviewing her, and she's just been stealing the show. I mean, I'm just kind of a prop.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And how has your audience, have they been responding to this lockdown comedy? What have been some of the feedback, if you've heard from people who that you may not know, but other strangers who have been introduced to being able to have stand-up brought into their home?
People have loved it. In the beginning, we had 150 to 250 people. Now we have still a pretty good number, but it's about 100 people as people are starting to go back to live performances. But I've gotten emails from people all over the country. I get fan mail from my mother, who says, you know, people say, well, whoever the headliner is, I think the headliner is your mom. Or 1 month my mom wasn't performing because she didn't feel well, you know, and then they're concerned and email, ask how she's doing. I've gotten emails from people who are in small towns and they don't have comedy and they don't have a lot of cultural events to choose from. So they've been happy to have the comedy coming into their living rooms. In September, when I was back in San Francisco, I did a live in-person show at El Rio in the Mission outdoors called Comedy Al Fresco. And we had it also live streamed, and we had about maybe 75 people at El Rio and 75 people watching the show on live stream. And I looked at the box office sales and noticed that most people were from the Bay Area. So whether or not they just got lazy and they didn't want to get off their couch or still feel because of the pandemic, not wanting to get together with people or for whatever reason, you know, they were able to still watch the show from the comfort of their own home. So that's one silver lining of the pandemic has been being able to watch entertainment from all over the country, all over the world, just beamed into your house. You know, unlike, you know, obvious TV, Netflix, but watching live comedy shows, live musical shows. My mom and I watched Dionne Warwick from her living room to ours last year. It was fabulous.
Oh, yeah. You know,
I saw online she was going to be doing a concert. So I was like, yeah, let's watch her. And she was sitting in her living room.
I missed that one. I would have loved to have seen that one. I like that. I like all of what you're sharing, but the one thing that's striking me right now is that people in rural areas are able to tune in and really be introduced to people that they would not have met from diverse backgrounds. Like you said, your shows are always people from different backgrounds, attitudes, perspectives, religions, etc., and they're bringing those stories. And part of the story in our human story right now is where some of us are struggling hard to open consciousness around matters of race, gender identity, et cetera, all the things that we are both cursed and gifted with in our human time right now, that we have that it hurts, some of it hurts, but we also are gifted with the possibilities of making it better. And in our human time, is some of the isms we are faced with. And so your work, is your comedians and you and what you produce is going places where someone would probably not in their physical life meet some of your lineup folks, but can actually fall in life with them or just laughing with them. And that just move the just that piece of sand, grain of sand, it would move their world.
Exactly. And sexuality also. I am gay and sometimes on the lineup, like, Karen Williams is a lesbian, and then other times will be other queer performers. So, you know, people who might not have normally gone to a comedy show where there was a queer performer will have that opportunity to hear that comedian's perspective. Another thing that's come out of this is just my mom and I getting to know each other. I'm in my late 50s. I hadn't lived at home since I was 17 years old, and to live with my mom again at this point in both of our lives and get to know each other was definitely a gift and a silver lining of the pandemic and something I would never have imagined. Because, you know, I would, over the course of the 40 years since I left home, come home for a long weekend or maybe a week, but never months or a year, year and a half. So it's definitely been a present to both of us.
So a question, and I'm saying question like, you ask a question, you have to say question to a person. But I'm saying question is almost in preparation, because when you said that, I could feel that in my body. So then something it's a sensitive question, maybe if only to myself, to present it to you. What in the 40 years of being spot coming to see, what have you learned about yourself and your mother that is that you can share in this world of living together and doing comedy together?
Wow. I feel like I've learned so much about who my mom is, because, you know, you often just look at your parents as your parents and don't really even know much about how they tick or much about their history. And I've just learned so much about my mom's childhood just from daily conversations or songs that she sang when she was a kid, or, you know, I'll just make a reference of something that we said when we were kids that we thought was something that we had invented, you know, like, you know, some little ditty, and then ends up that she was doing it when she was a kid, you know, from Miss Lucy and the Steamboat, and the Steamboat has a bell and that whole thing. I don't know if you remember that. I thought it was something that we came up with. My mom's like, no, we did that. You know, so we've just gotten to know each other, and I don't think we knew each other. And, you know, can't really know people who you don't see each other that often, and the last that we were living together, I was a teenager. You know, I didn't know anything about life. And, you know, every so often I'll say something and my mom's like, oh, I didn't know that about you. Or, you know, I how come you never told me that? It's like, I don't know, because we just didn't see each other a lot. So, you know, we're catching up on lost time. So, you know, 30 years age difference between us, basically. So I'm turning 60 soon and she's 90.
Okay. And then when you say that, the 30-year difference, is that because there's memories of things when she walked into the world before you that...
Oh, no. I'm saying between us, there's 30 years age difference.
Okay.
So I'm turning 60 soon and she's 90.
Okay.
You know, you just learn about somebody when you live with them, the good and the bad. It's not all roses.
Of course, I mean, and it's not all, you know, we think about that, living in a community, living with someone, and it's not all good, but then at the same time, living in ourselves is not always all good, and not always, but it's a fascinating journey.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right?
No, I wouldn't trade this time in for anything.
Exactly.
It's been a ride, you know, and it's not over. And it's hard for us to leave each other. You know, I need to go back and take care of things in my life and see my friends and be in my community garden, which a friend is taking care of, and go to my favorite sushi restaurant. So, you know, it's hard to leave, but then once I'm back home, it's nice to be there. I wish there wasn't 3,000 miles in between the two locations, and also flying. I never liked to fly anyway, but now with the pandemic and flying with a mask on and the whole nine yards.
But, yeah, that's hard. That is a challenge for all of us. It really is. You know, I live in Hawaii now and am very hesitant. I mean, I flew a year ago, just about. And people are asking me, I have children. And so, and they're like, when are you coming to see us? And I'm just like, I'm just not really ready. Not quite. And so, so Thursday night, tell us details. Time to show how folks get on to see, to watch this beautiful show you put on and the lineup of wonderful folks.
Yeah. If you go to cityboxoffice.com, you can buy tickets and they're very reasonably priced and they're sliding scale. 10 to 20, whatever you feel like paying. So you go to cityboxoffice.com for tickets for that. The show is Thursday at 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern. And, oh, you're in Hawaii, 4 p.m. Hawaii time. What time zone is that? I know I sound stupid. I don't know the name of that time zone.
Exactly, and that's a good one for me. I think we never change, so we stay the same. But I think it's HST?
I have no idea. Hawaii Standard Time?
Yeah, I think so. But we always stay the same. And so, like, I'm from the Bay Area. So I know folks there, I know they're 3 hours ahead. And there might be our children that are 5 hours ahead. So it's like I had someone this morning text me. It was 8 o'clock their time, and it was 3 o'clock in the morning. I said, you really don't expect me to have this discussion.
They was like, this is bizarre. And it's really confusing living in two different time zones because I'm constantly thinking in Eastern and Pacific time now. And then I'm back in San Francisco since I was so used to being in Florida for a large chunk of time. I forget which time zone I'm on, if it's earlier or later. So I'm totally messed up.
How has this changed your... One of the things I've been thinking about, at some point I'm going back to do stand-up. When I feel grown enough, you know, that's a spiritual thing, grown enough to talk about what I want to talk about. And I know that has changed from when I left the Bay 2 years ago. I was at the Oakland Comedy Club a lot. And so now, I wonder how has it changed your comedy? Has your comedy, you noticed any shift in your comedy, how you deliver the stories you're telling? Since the pandemic, since all the changes you've experienced, living by coastal, coming out is by coastal,
For like 30 years that I've been doing comedy, I've talked a lot about my mom, and I've talked a lot about the Florida Jewish migration from New York to Florida and the retirement villages here, and now I'm living in it. So it's so funny, like everything I've made fun of, I've been living. So then some of my comedy has been about that, you know, about being where I've been making fun of, you know, and turning into, you know, eating early bird dinners at 4 o'clock and, you know, taking canals, that kind of stuff. Right. Also, I'm talking, I think, a little bit less about my mom because she's sitting right next to me when I'm performing. Suddenly I'm like, oh, wow, I can't make fun of you. You're standing there. And also you can't make fun of someone else on the bill, you know. On the comedy show. You know, and then there was a lot of stuff about the pandemic that I was doing because, you know, the coronavirus and 700,000 plus people dying of it in this country, not funny, but being, you know, wearing masks and washing down your groceries and all of that stuff, there's definitely humor in it. So I was talking a lot about that. And there's also the elephant in the room, like I found when you're starting to do online comedy shows, you couldn't just do the same material like, oh yeah, when I was at the movies the other day, I was like, no, you weren't at the movies, we're on lockdown. So it's like, you know, talk about what's really happening now. You know, when I was watching my Instacart shopper on my app the other day, you know, that's what I'm doing for entertainment.
Hell of a guys. I'm sure everybody's thinking right now in their minds, all the Instacart folks and everyone else is doing a lot online. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. What do you think about TikTok? That's in my thing. And
oh my God, I'm too old, aren't I? I've seen it, but I haven't tried it. I feel like it's fascinating to watch from afar. I don't 100% get it. When I'll see something has like a million views, I'm like, what? So I don't know. I don't really know a lot about it. I feel very old when it comes to certain technologies that I'm not very familiar with. And if I tried to have a conversation about TikTok, I would probably sound like I was 80 or 90 years old.
No, which is... You get exposed to people you never would have met in your life. They run, and so it was created for supposedly 30 and under, but what has happened is you have people from all over the world with all different backgrounds, with all different demographics, same as the shows you produce. And they get on for 1 minute, and then that's why people click like, and they get millions of followers and sponsors, et cetera. It's quite a lovely, wonderful thing. It's informative. It's my new obsession. People get a little bit annoyed because every time I talk to them, I give them some philosophical thing that's happened. I said, this came from TikTok, and they're like, is something wrong with her?
Well, I feel like I've just discovered Instagram, so I'm not up to TikTok yet. Though Kellyanne Conway's daughter, I think her name was Claudia,
she was speaking
out against mom and Trump.
Yep.
So I watched her TikTok videos. That's probably one of the only things I've watched on TikTok.
I'm going to email you a couple ones from TikTok, because what happens is if you don't get the right algorithms, you get all the crazy people who are naked sitting on their car talking about their toe color, nail polish. It didn't come out right. Uh-huh. You go like, oh, wow. Uh-huh. But there's comedians and there are people who got on there who never would have made it in traditional ways, which is why you're talking. I'm saying Lisa should be a part of TikTok, like clips of her comedy shows on TikTok, 1 minute scenes of that. Yeah. So I'll send you something and hope we
Maybe that's what's next, because I'm working right now on getting Kung Pao Kusha Comedy together. My tickets are going on sale next month, so I'm just sitting here getting all of that together. It's Jewish comedy on Christmas in a Chinese restaurant. It's been going on since 1993. Last year, the 28th year, we had it online, and doing it online again this year and the next year in person. But that would be probably something that I would need to learn about TikTok for, because I know nothing about it.
Yeah, I'll send you a couple things that have moved me. Like the one I've just gotten turned on to is the Korean kitchen cook. She was a lawyer. She was a lawyer, and then she just left that, and now she's a vegan Korean cook, and now she's on tour, quit her job, selling her books. I'm following the recipes because I'm trying to go plant-based as well. But as you were talking, okay. I'm like, Lisa needs to be on this. So the whole thing around being too old, no. And the slogan is ageism. That's all about ageism, that we get indoctrinated no matter how bold people are. That there's that one thing, ageism. And the thing that's going around now is that ageism is a gatekeeper to beauty.
Mm-hmm.
Because as people grow older, that's when their beauty comes out. Like, in the best example I could say in your life would be your mom.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And yeah. My grandmother left here at 96 a few years ago. I watched her in a restaurant in the South hold court with a group of waiters and waitresses and do what sit-down comedy. And that was not, that's just how she was naturally. Mm-hmm. And held attentive court. But definitely, and I'll send you something via email with a couple things you can glance at.
All right, well, maybe okay, Mom and I will have to do TikTok together, learn about it.
Oh, my, Lisa, you are such a producer. You and your mom on TikTok, are you kidding me?
As soon as I learn how to do it, I think that's our next activity.
Okay, you're going to absolutely do it because you'll adore it. I'll send you the information via email.
Okay,
so,
you can be my mentor.
Yeah, absolutely. As much as I've learned, I will send you that just to see y'all and just crack up. You're going to love it, and I think it's going to move like incredibly fast. So
anyone who's listening to this who's under 30 must be going, just rolling their eyes. I could see it from here. Oh, listen to
them.
If they're listening
right now, they're sitting there thinking, thank God there are women out there who saying there's life after 30 because their birthday's coming up, and they said, I might as well eat the whole freaking sheet cake myself because there's no life after 30. Why should I not eat the freaking cake? They're probably saying, oh, my God. This is how we do it in life, right? So last New Year's Eve with the show, you had people could go in different rooms. You had a setup. I thought that was brilliant. You had a
breakout room,
so people could. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So at Kung Fu Kosher Comedy, there are, when we do it in person, in reality, when there's not a pandemic, we have tables of 10, and either people sit with friendly strangers or they reserve an entire table of 10 for friends and family. So before the Zoom show last year, as well as this year, people will be able to, people could watch the show on Zoom or on YouTube Live. People who are watching it on Zoom can also reserve a breakout room for 4 people or 10 or 20 or whatever. Last year I had people who were meeting with friends and family from around the country, around the world, and you can just chat and eat together for an hour before the show starts in the breakout room, which are named like Barbara Streisand and Mazel Tov and things like that.
That was just brilliant. You're a wonderful producer, wonderful a comedian, also a world changer and fabulous. And
well,
now you're going to be famous on TikTok if it has anything to do with your job. So for everyone listening,
let's throw that out there. KosherComedy.com is the website to find everything.
All right. Thanks for being a time.
October 28th, internationally celebrated, Nikki is a major voice in the African-American tradition of dissent and black power affirmation. Her new collection of poetry and prose, Make Me Rain, addresses injustice and offers us an unfiltered look into her heart. The KPFA Zoom event with Nikki will be hosted by the wonderful Sabrina Jacobs. This will take place Thursday, October 28th, 7 p.m. For the Eventbrite tickets link, just go to the KPFA website, the front page, and scroll on down. Please join us.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.